Let us all stand and give honor to God's word. Our scripture reading today is from John chapter 13, verses 1 to 15. Now before the feast of the Passover, Jesus, knowing that his hour had come, that he would depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. During supper, the devil having already put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come forth from God and was going back to God, got up from supper and laid aside his garments, and taking a towel, he girded himself. Then he poured water into the basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. So he came to Simon Peter. He said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I do you do not realize now, but you will understand hereafter." Peter said to him, "Never shall you wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no part with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, then wash not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "He who has bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you." For he knew the one who was betraying him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and taken his garments and reclined at the table again, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example that you also should do as I did to you." Jesus himself spoke these words.
Can we close our eyes and take a moment to pray, please? Lord God, our Father in heaven, as I prepare to give this sermon, I confess to you that I deserve nothing. Everything, Father, should be about you. Let it be that you speak to people's hearts. Let it be that they know your wisdom. Let it be that they know your strength, your guidance, that you are with them and you will never leave them and never abandon them. Let every person here know your presence. Let my words disappear, and let people only hear you, Father, speaking to their hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We've been using a sermon series on the Gospel Project, as we've been saying. We've been doing this for quite some time, going through the life of Jesus, the events in his life, the people that he met, his teaching, particularly the teaching of the parables, the miracles that he performed. And recently we started talking about the crucifixion and the resurrection, that last week of his life, as he was anointed in preparation for his burial, his entry into Jerusalem. These events together they're called the Passion Week. The Sunday is a triumphal entry. The Monday is he clears the temple. Tuesday, when he teaches in the temple. Wednesday, the rest day. Thursday, the day we're talking about today, the Last Supper and his arrest. Friday, trial, crucifixion, and burial. Saturday, in the tomb. And Sunday, resurrection. So as we look specifically at this Last Supper, this last meal that he's looking at, we read in Luke chapter 22, 15 to 16, some of the background, where this happened, what was going on. And he said to them, and Jesus said to them, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall never eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." What type of meal is it, this Last Supper, this meal that he's sharing with his disciples? I look at these words that he said, and he said, "I will never eat again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And I realize that this is a farewell meal. He's been with his disciples for 3 years. walking the roads with them, teaching them, sleeping alongside of them, eating meals with them. But now he is saying goodbye. Not that he will never see them again, but when he does, it will be different, because he will have been through the crucifixion and been through the resurrection, and everything will have changed. The person that they've worked with, that they've walked with, the person that they've learned from, the person that they spent so much time with, everything will have changed. And so he says goodbye. This is a very difficult thing to do. I know with the start of the school year, many teenagers, many children are going away, going off to America, going to other countries, going to places to continue their studies. This means for their mothers, for their parents, for their fathers, this means somehow you have to say goodbye. You will see them again. But when you do, it will be different, because they will have gone through new experiences. They will be older. They will have learned new things, and things will have changed. And this is the type of thing that he faced, Jesus faced, as he met with his disciples. He will meet them again, but it will be different. So it is time to say goodbye to a phase in his life, a time that they had spent together. This is discussed in the Bible in all four of the Gospels, in Matthew chapter 26, Mark 14, Luke 22, and John has a lot on it. He has John chapter 13 through to John chapter 17, and each of these gives us different perspectives on this last meal, this farewell. We read in Luke chapter 22, verse 7, "Then the first day of the unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed." So we know that as this Last Supper was coming, we know when it's occurring. It's the Passover, a special celebration. It's the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, which goes for 7 days, and the first of those 7 days is the actual Passover sacrifice. And it's important to realize that the timing of it, the timing of this Last Supper, that it occurs at this time, during this Feast of the Unleavened Bread, the Passover sacrifice. What is the Passover? Why is it important? The Passover goes back to the time in Egypt. We read about it in Exodus. Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 and 3. "Now the Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt." So this is why the Israelites were slaves before they had been led out of Egypt. "Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, they are each one to take a lamb for themselves according to their father's households, a lamb for each household." And what is to happen to that lamb? It continues in verses 6 and 7. "You shall keep it, the lamb, until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel is to kill it at twilight," that the lamb is to be sacrificed. "Moreover, you shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel," that means the top of the door of the house in which they eat it. So you have a scene, something like this, where the lamb has been killed and the blood is taken and painted along the two sides of the door and along the roof of the door, the top of the door. And it's painted for a specific reason. "For I will go, for God will go, for his angel will go through the land of Egypt on that night, and will strike down and will kill all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the house where you live, and when you see the blood, I will pass over you." It's important to realize that the Last Supper took place on that day, that it was connected with the Passover. The Israelites were in Egypt in slavery to the Egyptians. We face a similar situation. We are in slavery to sin. And because of that, we are separated from our God, and we will die in that sin. The Israelites sacrificed a lamb. But now they were to sacrifice the Son of God. This is what this Last Supper is all about as they are moving towards this sacrifice, when he, Jesus, will become the Passover lamb and we will have life where we should have had death. We read about this Last Supper, about how it began in Luke chapter 22, verses 8 and 12. And Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us so that we may eat it." They said to him, "Where do you want us to prepare it?" And he said to them, "When you have entered the city, a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house that he enters. And you shall say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher says to you, where is the guest room in which I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' And he will show you a large furnished upper room. Prepare it there." This is a little bit like when he entered into Jerusalem and he said, "Go and you will find this donkey, and come and take the donkey for me to ride." It could be miraculous. It could be that he'd arranged it, because we know that he had been through Jerusalem many times. Perhaps this is a time, and he said, "Can I use this room of yours?" And he just sent them. Maybe the man was carrying the pitcher as a signal. Find the man carrying the pitcher of water. Or it could have been miraculous, whichever you're more comfortable with, because the Bible doesn't tell us whether you see this as being a miracle, that he knew this, had this knowledge in advance, or it had simply been arranged, that it is someone that he'd met on his previous trips. But we see it this way, that as before the Passover lamb, during this feast time, that Jesus sent Peter and John to set up for him, and the meal was to be prepared in the upper room. The Last Supper, if we look at it very simply, and what it means to us, we could say it simply means this, that Jesus sat at the table with his disciples, and that he instituted the Lord's Supper. From this last meal, we get the Lord's Supper. As Baptists, as Protestant church, we recognize two ordinances. We recognize baptism, which you perform once, as a sign of beginning a Christian life. And we recognize the Lord's Supper, this ordinance which is repeated, whether it's repeated daily, whether it's repeated monthly, whether it's repeated weekly or yearly. It's an ordinance that is repeated, and it's a sign of continuing in fellowship with Christ. We need to look at this Lord's Supper, and we need to understand it, to realize what was given on that day. Matthew 26, verses 26 to 28, while they were eating, Jesus and the disciples, while they were eating together, Jesus took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood in the covenant, my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." What is it all about? What do we see in this supper? What was to happen? What was to come that evening and the next day? What do we see and what do we remember as we each month celebrate together, as we remember the Lord's Supper? It can be remembered in this verse, John 15:13, "Greater love has no one than this, that one laid down his life for his friends." And we look at the Lord's Supper and we see Christ's love for us, that he loved us, that he gave his life for us. He loves us individually, each one of you, as an individual, not simply as a congregation, as a group, but individually. He knows your name and he loves you. And Jesus, as a person, loves you as a person. And through his sacrifice, you have the blessings of salvation. What are these blessings that we receive, that we remember, that we celebrate when we take the Lord's Supper together? Read in John chapter 6, verses 53 and 54, when Jesus spoke of predicting of then this would happen. And he said, Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat of the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in yourselves. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." Through partaking in the sacrifice of Christ, through accepting Jesus into our lives, we are given forgiveness. We are given love. But it's not simply that we are given it one off, but we are nourished spiritually. We continually grow in that love. We continually change. We continually follow a path that He leads us on, a path that leads us to life, a path that leads us closer and closer to become what God calls us to be. A path that we follow is God's sons and daughters who He loves more than we will ever understand in this world. As we take of this meal, the Lord's Supper, it's not simply a piece of bread. It's not simply a cup of juice that we share together. But it should be growth. That as we remember, as we pray, as we give thanks, we grow. We grow spiritually. We change. We hear His words from the past, and we see prophecy about the future. Then he, in Revelation chapter 19, verse 19, then he, the angel, said to me, "John, write, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb." And he said to me, "These are the true words of God." The blessing of salvation includes a future. And the Lord's Supper is a foretaste of that future, that one day we together will sit at the great banquet of the King, that we will share in this together. That is our future. That is what we will share together. And particularly sharing is important. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 17, "Since there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we are all to partake of the one bread." We eat. We drink, remembering that we are united. We look to each other and call each other brother and sister. We look to God and call Him our Father, because we share in that. We are members of Christ's eternal family. This is what we share in. When He talked at the Lord's Supper, when He began the Lord's Supper, when He brought this in and gave this as a gift to us and said, "Remember, do this when you eat, do this when you drink, share this together. These are the things that we share together, that we together share Christ's love, that He loves every one of you. He knows you by name and He loves you. And He gave His life for you." And we have the blessings that come from His sacrifice, the blessings that come from His broken body, the blessings that come from His spilled blood, that we grow, that we change, that we follow the journey that He leads us on to become what He calls us to be, that we have a future, an eternity with God, that we will be His into eternity, and that we are united, not simply in this church, but united with all Christians throughout all time and throughout all places. This is what the Lord's Supper is about. And at that meal, that final meal, as Jesus was saying goodbye, He was saying, "Remember, remember that the future that I have for you, remember the great love that I have for you, remember the blessings that I give you, remember." We could simply look at that meal, that Last Supper, and say that was all what it was about, Jesus with His disciples and the Last Supper. The Lord's Supper, that He instituted this. But we look at this meal and we can also see so many other things going on. In fact, when I look at this meal, I don't know if I would want to be there, because it wasn't an easy thing. It's difficult to say goodbye, but it's difficult particularly in these circumstances when we read what was happening in this upper room at this table. Luke chapter 22, verse 24, "And there arose a dispute among them," among the disciples, "as to which one of them was regarded to be the greatest." great Lord's Supper, great ending. Imagine you're having a farewell with you're saying goodbye to your daughter who's about to go, and suddenly your brother and your son and your daughter start arguing about who's more intelligent, who's better looking, who's more popular. And instead of having a nice, peaceful farewell, you start this type of argument. And Jesus dealt with this as he sat with the people, as he sat with his disciples, as he heard their arguments. He dealt with them. And he said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who have authority over them are called benefactors. But it is not this way with you, but the one who is the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like the servant." So we have these events, that he sits down with his disciples. The exact progress of events, how they happen, we don't know because the Gospels are not clear about the sequence of events, but it seems that perhaps very early they started arguing about who would sit close to Jesus, who was the most important. But that wasn't all. Other things were going on at this Last Supper. Matthew 26, verse 21, as they were eating, Jesus said, "Truly, I say to you that one of you will betray me." They're having dinner, having a meal with a traitor, somebody that's been with Jesus for 3 years, somebody that's heard his teaching, somebody that's seen his miracles, somebody that's had meals with him so many times, yet it's somebody who will betray him. And Judas, who was betraying him, said, "Surely it is not I, Rabbi." Jesus said to him, "You have said it yourself." And then we know that after Jesus identified him, that Judas was to leave the meal. What else was happening? Matthew 26, verse 31. Then Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away because of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike down the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.'" Not only is there a traitor, not only are there arguments about who is most important, but he knows what will happen. That when his arrest comes, they will leave him. They will run away. They will abandon him. Jesus knows this will happen. And his answer to this is, "But after I have been raised, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." That he will forgive them. That he will restore them as his disciples. He will send them as his apostles. But we read about Peter. "But Peter said to him, 'Even though all may fall away because of you, I will never fall away.' Jesus said to him, 'Truly, I say to you, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. This is the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper that he shared with his disciples. This time, before he was about to be arrested, before he was facing trial, before he was going to be whipped, before he was going to be nailed to a cross, this last meal with his friends. Arguments about who was greatest. Betrayal, that one of them would go to the priests and sell him for money. One of his closest disciples would deny even knowing him. It must have been a very difficult meal. At that meal, so much pride and so much jealousy going on. Betrayal and greed going on. Cowardice and denial that was to happen in the future. How do you respond to that? He gave us the Lord's Supper and said, "This is your future. This is what I will do for you. When you take this bread, this is my body." Which is broken for you. When you drink from this cup, this is my blood. Which is spilled out for you. And yet, how do you see these things in the background, these things going on still at this meal? The pride, the jealousy about who is better, who is more important. The man thinking about, "Well, what can I get for myself? What can I make? How much can I get for selling this man to the authorities?" together at this meal. The ones he knew would betray him, would deny him. And no, my response, I wouldn't want to be there. I'd say, I'm finished with you. I've wasted 3 years with you. But Jesus isn't me. And Jesus' response was very different. John chapter 13, verses 3 to 5. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come forth from God and was going to back from God, got up from the table, laid aside his garments, and taking a towel, he girded himself. Then he poured water into the basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. These men who would betray him, these men who were proud and arguing about who was up better, these men who were jealous of one another, jealous about position, jealous about importance, jealous about who is closest to Jesus, jealous about who is most holy. The ones who would deny him, who would run away from him, who would betray him. These are the men that he stood at this table, that he stood up from them, and he knelt down, the creator of all the universe, kneeling down at our feet, because the disciples are so much like us, to wash our feet. For the disciples, particularly Simon, this was a difficult thing to take. So he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, do you wash my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, What I do, you do not realize now, but you will understand hereafter. Peter said to him, never shall you wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part of me. And it's the same with all of us. We are unclean because of that sin in our hearts, that pride in our hearts, that jealousy, unforgiveness, all those things that we hold in our hearts, all those things that separate us from God. But it was the sacrifice that he was offering us, that we are washed clean in his blood, that we have made acceptable to God. And without that, we can have no part of God. He cannot see us. He cannot accept us. And he finished with these words, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, wash your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example that you also should do as I did to you. How do you say goodbye? Because that's what this supper was all about, this Last Supper. When he would see them again, but when he saw them again, everything would be different because he had been through the crucifixion, the resurrection. When they see him again, they would fall at his feet and call him God. But now it was the man who had been their teacher, the man who had walked the roads with them, the man who had taught them, the man that they had seen sleeping, the man that they had seen eating, the man that they had lived life with. And he was saying goodbye. What happened at that Last Supper? Jesus gave us a gift. When he instituted the Lord's Supper, he let us know what we are. We are sinners, like those disciples, those proud, jealous, arguing men, those greedy people who betray, those people that argue. That's us, because every one of us does it. Every one of us is proud. Every one of us is jealous. Every one of us struggles to forgive. Every one of us has those things inside of us. Know what we are? Sinners. But sinners who are loved by God. And he gave his son to die on the cross for us. That's who you are. A sinner who is loved. And through that love, through the sacrifice of Christ, that he laid down his life for you, you become a son or daughter of the living God. When we look at the Lord's Supper, we have a gift of knowing who we are. But he gave us more than that. He gave us an example of knowing who we are, then what should we do? The Creator, the ruler of all the universe, put on a towel, knelt down, and washed their feet. And we, knowing that we are sons and daughters of God, and that Christ died for us, we're called to do the same. Perhaps not with water, but we wash each other's feet in different ways. We forgive what needs to be forgiven, let go of what needs to be let go of, help to grow the people who are struggling, love the people who are unlovable. This is the example that he gave us. When he said goodbye, this was how he said it. He told us who we are, sinners who are loved, forgiven, and who will belong to God. And the example of, because of that, this is what we are to do. This is the way we are to live. When we look at the disciples, we can see that every one of us, if we're honest, we have those things. I have to constantly remind myself, this church, this sermon, this congregation is not about me. It's about God. God loves you. God calls you. This church belongs to Him. You belong to Him. We struggle with pride. We struggle with jealousy. We struggle to forgive. We hold on to things for days and months and years, things that we should let go of. But we look to the Lord's Supper for the gift that was given and the example of the way we are to live. Whatever it is that you struggle with, whatever it is that you say, this is the example I should follow, that I should wash my friend's, my neighbor's feet by forgiving him, by loving him, by caring for him, by helping him to go, then this is the time to pray and to turn over to God and to ask him, let me forgive, help me to do this, help me to follow your example. Thank you that I belong to you. Just help me to follow and become what you call me to become. Can we take a moment and can we pray, please? A prayer of thanks for what Jesus has given us, but also a request saying, Father, let us follow the example that Jesus has given us. Lord God, our Father in heaven, we turn to you, Lord, with hearts full of love and hearts full of gratitude as we remember the sacrifice of Jesus, his body that was broken on the cross, his blood that was poured out upon the ground. And because of that, we can look to you and call you our Father and know that you love us, know that you forgive us, know that you belong, that we belong to you. We can know who we are, Father, sinners, but sinners who are forgiven, sinners who are loved. Sinners who have a future, that belongs to you. Let our hearts be full of gratitude, Lord. Let our hearts be full of love, and let that love drive out fear. Let that love drive out jealousy. Let that love drive out pride, Lord. Your love, Father, let it fill our hearts that we follow the example of Jesus. He knew what he was, that he came from God, that he came from you, Father, and because of that, he could take the towel and wash the disciples' feet. Let us know what we are, Lord, that we are your sons and daughters. And knowing that, let us follow his example. Let us wash each other's feet. Let us forgive what needs to be forgiven. Let us love, especially when those who need love so much, Lord. Father, thank you so much for this Last Supper that was recorded in the Bible and all that means to us, Lord. Thank you so much, Father. And as everybody continues to pray, perhaps there is somebody who has not yet accepted Christ into their life. You don't know the love that Jesus had for you, the sacrifice that he paid, the price that he paid for your life. Understand what you are. You're a sinner, the same as all of us. We all feel pride, we all feel jealousy, we all feel anger, we all feel unforgiveness. But those things have separated you from you, and you cannot be together with God because of that darkness in your heart. But Jesus died on the cross to pay the price for everything you have ever done and everything you ever will do. It's a gift. All you have to do is say yes. Is there anybody here today who wishes to accept Jesus into their life today? Just raise your hand and let me lead you in a prayer. Is there anybody here today who wishes to accept this gift that Jesus offers us? Anybody? Lord God, my Father, I thank you for these, my brothers and sisters in Christ. I ask for your blessing upon every one of them, Lord. Let them know your love. Let them remember what they are. Children of the living God, bought by the blood of your Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.